everyone, and welcome to Throw Like a Girl Radio, Brooklyn College Radio's first all-female sports talk show. I'm Alyssa Paolicelli.
And I'm KaraAnne Galante.
Today is Wednesday, November 4th, and as always, thank you for tuning in to Throw Like a Girl Radio today. If you're listening to us, you're listening to us in a number of different ways. You might be streaming off of mywbcr.com or have downloaded the TuneIn Radio app and search Brooklyn College Radio. If not, those are the two ways you can do so. Make sure you're following us on all of our social media accounts, facebook.com/throwlikeagirlradio, Twitter at @throwlikea_girl, and Instagram, @throwlikeagirlradio. Subscribe to our YouTube and iTunes podcast by searching Throw Like a Girl Radio.
All right, guys. So we're not going to lie. Today is still pretty depressing. We're still dealing with the after effects of the World Series loss, but we'll get to that soon. But at least now it's hockey season. We could focus our, we could shift our focus to hockey and football and talk to you guys about that. Basketball has started.
We should probably try and talk about that at some point.
I know. We should when we get a chance, because there's so much news that's come out in both basketball, baseball, hockey, football. It's crazy. So if you guys want to join in our conversation, you could always call 718-951-4444. Again, the number is 718-951-4444. So we're going to start off this week, as we always start off, with our top story of the week. So I was going through Facebook, which is totally like a reliable news source, Facebook, and I came across this video, and it's called #CoverTheAthlete. So I want you guys to listen and let us know what you think. Here it is.
You're getting a lot of fans here. A lot of them are female, and they want to know if you could date anyone in the world. Who would you date?
Any response to recent comments about your girlish figure?
Are you serious?
Removing your body hair gives you an edge in the pool. How about your love life?
How has your weight gain affected your mobility?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Have you heard the controversy over your helmet hair?
Get ready to see some great biceps, tiny tanks, and more.
I wonder if his dad said to him when he was younger, listen, you're never going to be a looker, you're never going to be a Beckham, so you have to compensate for that.
He really does have the kind of body international judges love.
Could you give us a twirl and tell us about your outfit?
What? Bro, what are you talking about, man? Bro, I'm out, man.
So that is the Cover the Athlete campaign, which is a little bit like there was a campaign on the red carpet where it asked her questions or something like that.
Yeah.
And it's basically the idea that female athletes and female actresses are always asked about their appearance, their look, and their figure,
as opposed to their work on the field or not.
But yeah. A little background. We tweeted out the link. We'll post it on our Facebook page. Although the audio, you can hear the questions that they're asking, it's a voiceover. Those questions weren't actually asked at press conferences for these athletes, because that would just never happen. But
it happens to females all the time, but not male athletes. All the time. So didn't that sound stupid?
What do you mean?
Like those questions, right?
I mean, but the thing is, that's the reality of it. And the whole sports media industry feeds into this in so many different levels.
Mm-hmm.
Because there is such limited coverage of females in sports, it makes it worse, because this is the coverage that they're getting.
Yeah, and you know who was asked to twirl was Eugene Bouchard, who won the second round of the Australian Open in January 2015. And on the court interview, instead of talking about, how did she win, her tactics, all this stuff, she was asked, can you twirl for me? Because of what she was wearing. And come on, guys. You got to do a better job in reporting. You don't ask, can you twirl? Just ask what happened on the court.
The PSA has been made by Jessica Schnurr and Hannah Smith, who are two creative consultants at a branding agency called John Saint. John Street. They made a video in which professional male athletes look flabbergasted or dumbstruck when they're asked the same exact question. So you could hear the audio on here, but you actually weren't able to see the faces on the athletes.
Yeah.
They opened up with Sidney Crosby. They had a bunch of soccer players, some basketball player, Russell Westbrook was in there.
Yeah. Swimmers, Michael Phelps was there.
But I was telling Kara before this, I did a 10 page paper on this topic about the media industry and how they did a depiction of women, both female and female athletes, as well as female broadcasters.
Mm-hmm.
And if you look at local news outlets, we were talking about the limited coverage on female sports. There's only about 5% of coverage of female sports on ESPN, as opposed to ESPN, which has 2%. So imagine that. Local coverage of sports has a higher percentage of covering women's sports than ESPN.
That's insane.
The hub of sports coverage.
Because ESPN is ESPNW too, so I'm very surprised about how low ESPN covers.
But ESPNW is a strictly online platform. It's just a website. There's no...
It's just like throwing us a bone. Like, here's an online platform. And
I mean, I think they do great work, but...
No, they do. Like, I've been reading articles, and it's just amazing what these women have put out there.
Female athletes are often spoken about by using women's stereotypes, most commonly females associated with childness. So you will hear America's Sweetheart referred to as,
yeah,
you know, on the court and on the field. And they stereotypes that youthful innocence. And
yeah. Like, oh, that's cute, what she just did.
Exactly.
Or something like that.
They're also more likely to be referred to as first name by their first name,
mm-hmm,
and during a broadcast than by their last name. And if you think about it, the way in sports when you rank the hierarchy of people, you refer to them as their last name,
yeah,
as a sign of respect.
It's on their backs of their jersey.
Right, exactly. But for females, they are not referred to as that. And what are some other things that...
Yes, give them some interesting...
It is more the more coverage of female sports, other sports like gymnastics, like tennis, like, yeah, all these other things that speak to the gracefulness, the more quote-unquote feminine sports, because,
yeah,
that's what's appealing to is believed to be the target audience for sports viewers. So not only is it limited, but it's strategically placed in sports that are going to appeal to the audience of what the females are playing.
Like, plus, those are Olympic sports, too.
That's true, and that's where you see the most coverage,
yeah,
of women's,
yeah,
sports is in the Olympics.
Most invested in, too, money-wise.
Let's see, what else? Oh, yeah. Also, the media describes emotion of female athletes. The way the media describes emotion of female athletes is different than that of men.
Yeah.
Often when a female, expresses negative emotion or... is angry about a play, she's unsportsmanlike. But if a guy does that,
it's like, yeah,
he's so intense,
yes,
he's passionate.
So into the play.
Right. So there's just all these double standards,
yeah,
within the industry, and it's really interesting to look at. There's so many studies done. There's so many.
It's getting better, though.
It has been getting better,
it still has
this, and it all goes into that whole depiction of how what the sports industry thinks that the population still perceives women in sports as, and they're still trying to feed that stereotype, which still exists but is still continuing to,
yeah,
be broken down on several different types of levels.
You know what I realized? That Katie Nolan's garbage time was moved to Wednesdays at like 12 a.m.
Really?
Yeah.
I
it used to be
why.
What on Sundays from at like 9:30 p.m.
Yeah,
they moved
on,
it.
It went on after NYCFC's broadcast.
Yeah, but still, I'm not gonna stay up at 12 o'clock at night.
That's true.
But
I mean, at least she does have her YouTube platform, which is where she
began.
No,
her YouTube platform is great with the viewers.
So she's able to do that. But
still, the TV, you want to break out into TV, and she's not really getting that chance as much.
That's true. But I mean, at least
she was at the World Series, though. I saw her.
I saw her. You saw her there?
I saw her underneath the ground. Where we have to walk in.
The tunnel?
The tunnel.
Underneath the ground. The tunnel.
I forgot that. I saw her. She was there.
I saw her Instagram post, but I didn't see her.
It's very exciting. I passed by her.
She said hello.
I know.
She totally would have.
I know, but then she was working, and then I was thinking.
She wasn't working, was she?
Yeah, she
was
working.
With Fox or she was there with Fox Sports, because I thought she was there with her friend.
She was there with Fox Sports. I saw a guy next to her. I didn't see her friend in the picture. She was doing something, because she was walking towards the field. But
cool.
Yeah, it was cool.
There were so many people there. I was really hoping I'd run into Erin Andrews at some point.
I know, me too.
But we'll get to that.
Yeah,
we'll talk about that.
Oh, well, right now we're going to sign off, and we're going to take a little break. So Throw Like a Girl is WBCR's first all-female sports radio talk show with myself, Karen Galante, and Alyssa Paolicelli. We'll be right back with you after a short break. Make sure to follow us on Facebook.com, such as Throw Like a Girl Radio, Twitter at @ThrowLike_Girl.
Tweet us,
and
Mets
tweet
fans,
us,
if you're listening. Tweet
please
us what
tweet
was the
us.
Most. Tweet us what was your most devastating memory from this World Series run, or not devastating memory. There is no happiness in this, Carol. This is the worst.
No,
I'm like seriously depressed.
I know.
Tweet us what you thought was the most frustrating play, or something like that, along those lines.
Yeah, or call us 718-951-4444. So right now, you guys are going to be listening to the post game comments made by none other than Mr. Dark Knight himself, Matt Harvey, after a devastating World Series loss.
The way the game was going. The last thing I wanted to do was not finish what I started, and it was obviously disappointing. I felt so great all game, felt so great in the ninth. Wanted the ball, and I gave it everything I had.
Could you feel the electricity out there? I mean, the fans even wanted you to come back. They were chanting your name.
Absolutely. It was hard for me to leave. And, you know, you get in a situation like that. We're up two runs and kind of cruising through the game. You know, one pitch here and you know, it's a different ball game. But, you know, they were awesome. They've been awesome all year. It was a blast to be out there. I had, you know, so much fun tonight. It was incredible. The energy was incredible, but you know, unfortunately, I just couldn't finish what I started.
Matt, did you have to do it over?
Just as strong coming out for the night?
Yeah, I felt normal. Same as I did in the eighth, same as I did in the first inning. And, you know, it's one of those things where, you know, a team like that just kind of puts the ball in play. I felt like I made a good pitch, 3-2, and you know, Kane let off the with the walk. And you know, it's just one of those things that this team you know, that we're playing against obviously showed a lot and put the ball in play and unfortunately I just couldn't get it done.
They're like a girl radio, WBCR's first all-female sports talk show with Alyssa Paolicelli and KaraAnne Galante is back. You just heard the very somber thoughts, post-game thoughts of Matt Harvey after he went in to finish the game in the ninth inning of Game 5
Blown
of the
it.
World Series and did not finish what he started, ended up with a loss. So Mets fans, if you want to join in on our misery, please feel free because I have been, I literally have been, as soon as that final out was made on Sunday night, I have been dreading this segment of the show since then. I don't even want to talk about this, but we have to.
I want
to
go on my
rant.
So
718-951-4444, you can call in at any time. Mm-hmm. And maybe comfort me if you're not a Mets fan. I don't know.
If you guys want to comfort Alyssa Paolicelli, so, please call.
Kara.
Okay.
This just sucks.
Okay, we should just do overall how the series was overall. Let's not go inning by inning.
No, I don't want to go inning. I don't even want to think about this. I'm still
okay,
in mourning.
Let's just go overall your experience in the World Series because we had the honor of actually working.
Oh, yeah, the honor.
Of working the World Series. But this,
I don't know if I would call it that. No, I'm kidding. It was really cool to be there and be a part of it. And our professor Dumphy is outside making fun of us at our pain
and misery
as Mets fans. Thank you for that.
Yes, thank you. Oh, he came back. He came back for our current qual. Okay, so if you guys have been living under a rock for the past couple of days, the Mets have lost the World Series against the Kansas City Royals, and we lost 7-2 in 5 games, and we led
for 40. We led for 43
yes.
of the 51 innings.
Yes,
43. But you know what? That's just irrelevant because baseball is cruel sport.
Yes,
and that stat means zero.
No,
nothing.
It means
absolutely
nothing. It means nothing. And that's what's frustrating. It doesn't mean anything.
The worst part about working it was that you had to work after they lost. Like so, I had.
Oh, Alyssa had to. I went straight home, girl.
No, I had to be there till late at night, and I had to like talk to people, and there was a bunch of Kansas City Royals fans that came into the store, obviously to get programs, to get some things, and it was horrible. I was miserable. I wanted to go home, and I literally on Monday I got home so late. I had class the next day on Monday. I had to go in because I had something to do. I had to hand out in a midterm. I went to my class, dropped off my midterm, drove home, went to the store, picked up a pint of ice cream and an apple pie, went in my bed, ate all those things, and slept for the rest of the night. I was telling Kara, like, I'm a big Rangers fan.
Yes,
obviously
but
a
this
big
is
Mets fan.
Her
this,
baby.
This stings more than anything because they're my first love. Like, baseball is my first love.
Yes,
my first
no,
thing I
thing.
Actually, like, felt
same
passion
thing.
For. And it's horrible.
It's absolutely
horrible because
okay.
there's nothing you can do about it. But you know that your team should have won. And
No, we should have won. No,
we should have won the whole thing on Sunday. That's the part that makes me so upset. Like,
I know, we should have.
Oh, my God. It just sucks. It sucks so
much. It's coming out now. She looks like she's going to...
Oh my God! I can't. I had to delete the MLB app yesterday because I don't know why I have my Mets favorite as my favorite team on the app.
I know.
They still updated me on the Royals parade. Like, why would you do that? You clearly know I do not want to see that.
Wait, are you okay?
I couldn't go on social media. I unfollowed them on.
No, no, me neither.
Instagram,
I skipped everything
on Twitter,
scrolling?
On everything because
yeah,
I couldn't
no.
deal with it.
But let's just think about this, Alyssa. I have to say you were right about Daniel Murphy. I have to apologize.
Oh, yeah.
I think you should take back your apology to him.
No, I can't.
Because
he got us to where we needed to
no,
be.
No,
but
he did. But, dude, you're defensively wise, he wanted to get in front of the ball.
He's a free agent now. He wanted to make himself a campaign that he should only be a DH, well, and he did that. Well, clearly.
He wasn't swinging during the World Series because they're pitching him in.
The Royals did something that no
pitching him inside.
Exactly, the Royals did something that no other team they had played. They made him uncomfortable.
That's his weakness.
And also, I really think that the break just cooled him off so much, and he just never had an opportunity to get heated back up again.
I think just pitching inside just ruined him, honestly. And
no,
defensively,
he turns it on the inside pitch. He turns it on the inside pitch, and he is able to crush that.
I know.
He's done that before, but they just made him more uncomfortable. I think that his pitch selection was a little bit too picky. But defensively speaking, he made two
But he kept
huge,
complaining, though.
Huge. He always complains.
Alyssa, he kept complaining to the umps during the whole,
he
even playoff-wise.
He always does that, Kara. Oh, he does that through the
oh my God,
regular
dude,
season games. He always does
the
that.
The umps weren't that consistent, though, I have to admit. I know they were all, first World Series umpires, inexperienced, number one. And the calls weren't as consistent plate-wise. What are you doing, home plate umpires?
That's besides the point.
I know, but still.
No matter if they were consistent or not, the Mets had plenty of opportunity to win those games.
No, but it's just frustrating.
Daniel Murphy made two huge errors.
Yes, that cost us
that
the game.
Were two routine double play ground balls that he could not turn, and... I mean, I don't know. There's that. I don't know what was worse. That, because that play made the game get away from them. They couldn't.
No, it did.
But also, Lucas Duda.
Oh.
Let's just talk about something. Okay. Basic baseball logic, especially as a first baseman. You don't have men. As a first baseman, your main job is what? To catch the ball and step on the base. That's really what your job
basically,
is.
Basically. That's one thing you got
to
do.
There's very few plays where the first baseman is involved in, strategical, throwing of the ball.
Yeah. Maybe
when,
a bunt. Maybe that's probably
when
one of the
you are a first baseman.
Yes.
And there's a runner on third, and you're up only one run in a game of this magnitude. You don't care about that run at first. You get the out at home because that's the one that matters.
But okay, it was ground ball to David Wright.
And
David Wright checks the runner.
He had him dead.
No,
for
he was six feet. No, it was
by 6 feet. And if he just made a regular throw,
no, if it was a perfect throw, he would have gotten him out. He was halfway down the baseline. So much more room. Oh my God, Lucas and Darnell. You need to learn how to throw to second base. You need to learn to get runners out when they steal because Kansas City was running all over him.
Well, Kansas City does that.
He needs to learn how to throw the ball because a lot of it was not on target. He just needs to work
everyone,
on that during the offseason.
Everyone had said that, counted us out of the series, that Kansas City was too good. It had too much of a agenda here to get back what they wanted from last year, which they did. And they were like that annoying fruit fly in your house that you can't seem to get rid of, but they always come back somehow. And I think they outscored the Mets something like 15-1 after the seventh inning or something crazy
which
is insane.
No, it was.
And
they're a good seventh inning on team, and that's what's scaring me. And Joe Buck had to say that stat.
Let's not talk about Joe Buck. The worst part about this.
Yes, what's the worst part? Give it to us.
Was that it's not like I couldn't forget about. Like the Rangers, the past two seasons have opened up their home opener by watching the other team, skate around with the cup, raise the banner.
I know.
The same thing. The Mets are going to be there. We're watching those rings get handed out, that banner get raised at, was it Kauffman Stadium in Kansas City?
Who cares? I don't even want to go there. The stat was the same thing as the Rangers, though. The Rangers lost in five games in the Stanley Cup Finals Tampa, and they were leading most of the games.
The sports gods or whoever's in charge of my sports happiness, what did I do in my past life as a sports fan?
I know, what did we do
happy?
That was so wrong?
I don't understand.
No, I don't get it either. And it's just...
And it was almost like the Rangers, the same thing. Like, they should have won.
They should have won against Tampa.
They should have been up 3-1 in game five. Just like the Mets should have been up 3-1.
Yeah.
Like, it's just, it really, when that final out was made, I felt like someone took my heart out
and
kicked me in the gut, put it back. And
I didn't even watch the final out. I went upstairs, I can't see them celebrate in my stadium on my field.
Oh, that was nothing. So I'm walking out and I see Hosmer getting poured over with champagne and Budweiser on my way out. Chris Young is with his son and all the championship guard.
Isn't that a great scene? I just shut the TV and I went to bed. I was like, I can't even watch that.
Pure torture.
All right, well, do you feel better now?
No.
A little bit.
You
got it off your chest.
I don't
though.
Feel better.
Got
I'm
it off
probably
going to
do the same exact thing tonight. I'm going to go finish the pint of ice cream that I bought the other day.
Oh, I got finished
this weekend. Just going to sleep. That's really all I want to do. I just want to sleep until Thanksgiving. I'm not going to smile again until Thanksgiving.
Okay.
Just think about next year.
We're
not talking about the Mets or the World Series again on this show. We're talking only free agency. We're talking MLB awards.
Okay, we'll do that. But I just want to say this one thing. Kansas City made it to the World Series last year, and they were inexperienced. They were a much experienced team now.
I hope this gives them a taste in their mouth.
Gives them the drive.
And next year we'll have Zach Wheeler back, and Terry Collins apparently is coming
back. 2-year extension, $3 million.
It's okay. I don't really care about that, but
I think I'm indifferent.
I'm indifferent.
I think he did a great job.
I think it took him too long to do a great job.
But what we had nobody. Who did we have?
We had pitching.
They had to be groomed.
Now there's nine Mets who are going to be on the free agency list.
We need to sign Addison Reed. I want to sign Addison Reed. Come on. Relief-wise, he was on point this season.
Only in the playoffs.
He was on point. That's what you need him the most.
Yeah, but you also need him to get you the playoffs, which he didn't help.
Well, what did we get him in, like, towards the end of the season?
Yeah.
Damn way.
But he wasn't consistent. That's why everyone was worried about him.
Tyler Clipper needs to go gone. I want him out.
I think, now who do you want more, Cespedes or Murphy?
Cespedes, it's illogical. You can't get him. With the amount of money he's asking for, we don't have that type of money. What was it like?
They need two bats. They need a reliever. And they need a middle infielder still. Ian Desmond's up there.
Murphy, they're not going
to
sign.
Zorbist is up there from Kansas City, who I would love to have. He's a second baseman, I believe.
Yeah, but how much are they asking for? You got to think about that, too.
But that, honestly, also, that's another thing. That's just you retract think about a little bit here.
Okay.
Because I think this is honestly one of the worst things that could have happened to the Mets. Going to the World Series after all these moves that they made in the trade
deadline.
Winning
at all.
That... Obviously, I always want them to win it all, but I do think now the mentality is going to be going into, okay, let's get whoever we need in the offseason just to get by, to be in playoff contention until the trade deadline, make the big move for a rental player, get us to the playoffs, and give us a run, because that's exactly what they did this year, and it worked, and their payoff wasn't high.
Payroll,
yeah.
It was like 64 point.
Which is, compared to all the other teams
it wasn't that much.
Exactly, so I'm saying.
Dodgers had the highest payroll in the league, and look where they went.
We can talk about the Dodgers in 2 seconds, because Zach Greinke, the news broke this morning. But think about that. Now, is that going to be the Wilpons, like, go-to strategy now? Like, hey, we don't have to spend all this dough, because
it might be, honestly.
We can make these moves. We can get us to where we need to be around July. Make that big move. Push for the playoffs and make our run. Get to the postseason and just push then.
And plus, City Field is a pitcher's ballpark anyway, and we have top pitching in the majors.
Well, maybe, they don't need to do anything with the pitching. They need to move for the bats.
We need offensive, we need hitting, because Dave Wright's getting older. Curtis Granderson is going to be 35 years old, and Kadir is what, almost 40.
Let's talk about something Kara said before the show. Kara had a problem with Curtis Granderson's play this season, I don't know what you're talking about, because this is the best season you're going to get from Curtis Granderson by far.
Okay, playoff-wise, he was good. He came in the clutch. He hit a home run.
He had the best World Series.
No, he did. Playoffs. I'm not taking away from playoffs for regular season.
In regular season, he was so consistent compared to last season. It's exactly what you want from him. It's exactly what we're going to get from him. Actually, you're not going to get that again.
No, we're not going to get it. He's aging. He's done. We actually need a whole new outfield. What do we have? Just Ligaris and Conforto? Because if Cespedes and then Granderson.
Yeah, you have Kadir. Just kidding.
We have Kadir. Wow. That
was a joke.
He was so good during the playoffs, wasn't he, Alyssa?
Wow,
those strikeouts.
I feel
really
bad talking about him badly, because his wife comes into the store all the time, and his son, and they're just like the nicest people.
I know, but you could be the nicest person. Like I said it last week, you'd be the nicest person, but if you're not producing on the field, I want you off my team.
Just a quick, interesting stat. The Mets featured 5 rookies to appear in the World Series, the most ever in history. Max, Syndergaard, Conforto, Robles, and Gilmartin. Let's move on quickly to other news around
the MLB. Can we do Pete Rose? I just want to do Pete Rose and A-Rod, because I thought their coverage was great, and I want to give them, like,
can we just talk about the only reason why that they were on the Fox broadcast was for ratings?
Yeah, but still, they were. Come on, I would listen to A-Rod, because he played against 90% of those
A-Rod
players.
A-Rod has a fabulous, fabulous baseball mind. It really is a shame because he did not need to do what he did to be the kind of player he was.
No, he doesn't. The way he sees the game.
There were so many reports that came out after his suspension was publicized, saying that they were concerned about his well-being because his life is baseball. They don't know what A-Rod is going to be without baseball. And you can see that in the way he talks about the game.
Yeah,
and he was a big proponent of DeGrom and the Mets
in
general.
No, he was. He said the Mets were going to win the World Series, which I was in shock that he said that. But I don't know. And then what sucked was that Pete Rose didn't finish the World Series broadcast. And I thought he was just a card. He was so funny. Honestly, it was enjoyable to watch compared to seeing, like, Joe Buck and...
Yeah.
I don't know. But A-Rod was... And people are saying that A-Rod should start being a broadcaster, forget about playing and retire already. But the money that he would be making from being a broadcaster compared to a player, come on.
I mean, he's definitely going to be... That's his next step in the industry. So.
Fox is going to sign him. Or MLB. Something's going to happen. Some network's going to sign him, and he's going to do great behind the desk. And Raul Ibanez was pretty good, too. I don't know. Everyone was... It was a good broadcast pregame, postgame, but during the game,
I think it's
horrible.
Always better. But the post the call was very bad. I thought the MLB should have done something about the biases that was taking place.
Oh yeah. Oh, I was so frustrated. But I had a feeling Kansas City was gonna win after Volk, because his father passed away and he pitched a day like it came.
No,
home.
I always thought my team was gonna win.
No, but you know when those things happen, those fluky things happen. It's just like.
I don't want to talk.
And
about
he was pitching.
I'm done talking
game
about the World
five.
Series. That's it.
You know
we're
something
done.
Was gonna happen.
Moving on.
All right.
National signed Dusty Baker as their head coach. We're talking about a little bit a couple weeks ago how this turmoil that's going on within the dugout with the Nationals, the Papelbon, Bryce Harper incident, but it kind of seems that this might be not only in the dugout, in the locker room, it might be in the front office as well. They chose Bud Black a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, that was weird.
As their head coach, said they would believe in him. Yeah. The contracts fall. The contract
they
talks
were offering
broke down
nothing,
over the weekend.
Though. They were offering nothing compared to
either
what they
way. It's kind of weird. It's kind of a little phony. Now they're coming out saying that Dusty Baker, who was up for the job a couple weeks ago, but then they ultimately chose Black over him. Now they're like, oh, no, he was always the guy for the job, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, just some background. I think this is a great move for them. I think he's really going to get that clubhouse into shape. If he can have winning division titles and a pennant with Barry Bonds and Jeff Kent coexisting on the same team in San Francisco, I think he can deal with Papelbon and all those other personalities, and the Bryce Harper personality in the Nationals locker room.
No, he can do it.
He has a .52 win percentage, 17th in all-time wins list, over 1,600 wins.
And third among active managers.
He was a three-time NL Manager of the Year with San Francisco. He's 20 years experience, 7 postseasons with 3 different teams, the Giants, Cubs, and
the
Reds.
What I don't get is they offered Dusty Baker more money compared to what they would have offered.
It's less years.
What was it? 2 years, it's 3.5 million. Yeah. They were going to offer him like 1 year below, I think, the 1 million.
I wasn't aware of what the contract
it was like
were,
nothing, though,
Black.
They were offering him. And they offered him more here, so I think it was just maybe a PR move. You never know.
Maybe.
You never
he
know.
He led the Giants to the 2002 World Series.
Yes, they did.
World Series. So I think this is a good move. I think he's gonna, get.
Yeah, because
he
have all these stats
all
the different
tools.
Teams.
He has all these tools in this clubhouse. The Nationals are always gonna be a force to reckon with in the NL East.
Yeah.
So hopefully, same thing will happen as they did last year, and the Mets will be back to where they are. But
no, the Mets are gonna be back to where they are. I guarantee. I'm gonna say it right now. They are. I don't care.
Kara, I really hope so. But if they go back, they have to win it all, or else I literally cannot take it. I cannot take another painful pain like this. Like I really can't.
Do the Rangers?
That sounds so dramatic, but it's so true.
I know. And also, Don Mattingly was hired head coach of the Miami Marlins, 4-year, $10 million deal, which is a lot of money in a very long time. He just left the Dodgers. Dodgers angst him as head coach. So now he's head of the Marlins. So we'll see what Marlins have a low payroll, too. They have, like, the lowest in the league, so he has to work with mainly nothing.
Yeah, he's Stanton. It's fine.
I know. They have youth, but that's... We'll work around that one player. We'll see what happens with the Marlins. So the Mets division next season might be a force to be reckoned with.
Yeah, I mean, it'll be fun. It always is one of the weaker
I know
divisions.
It is. That's
But, I mean, the Braves and the Phillies are still rebuilding, and they're still be in pretty bad shape next season. But talking about the Dodgers, Zach Greinke opted out of his contract this morning.
Yes, he did.
He became a free agent. Not a big surprise, but kind of like, wow, he's leaving 3 years on the table, a guaranteed 3 years, and a guaranteed
$71 million.
Dollars. He now is joining the 151 free agents.
I don't know how that's going to work out.
Which includes
insane.
A pretty stacked or considerable, a decent, a good pool of pitching. Johnny Cueto, Jordan Zimmermann, David Price. But now, think about this. David Price is a little bit more desirable than Greinke, because for the Dodgers at least, because they could pay him. He has the youth. I don't know. I can see David Price being moved out to replace Greinke in L.A.
We'll just see if he signs the deal. But who's Greinke gonna? Where's Greinke gonna go? That's the big question.
He might even go back to the Dodgers. The Dodgers might be able to bring him back with even more money. He has the 12
year career.
Have the money. They just gave him the three best careers of his life.
Yeah.
So I'm excited for free agency.
I know we're gonna get news breaking news. It's like it doesn't end, and I think that's great. Now let's move on to free agency. Forget about that. Well. That concludes maybe. It could be our final baseball segment. We might bring
it back
next week.
We'll talk about baseball, but we're not talking about the Mets. We're not talking about the World Series ever
unless
again.
The Mets acquire something or do something amazing, which I'm not expecting this offseason.
So tired.
Unless they
sign. Such lofty expectations. They have to do something. They'll figure it out.
They'll sign somebody.
The next time we'll be talking is whether
move.
Or not if Daniel Murphy gets re-signed as a Met or not. That's the next time I'll talk about
it. He's not going to be re-signed. No way, Jose. But... Well, guys, we're going to head into a break, and then we're going to talk some football.
Finally.
So if you guys want to call in, the number is 718-951-4444. Right now, you're going to be listening to highlights from the exciting Monday Night Football matchup where the Panthers won in overtime against the Colts. So we'll get to that soon.
What a finish it was in Charlotte, North Carolina. Monday Night Football, the rain was coming down as Cam Newton and the Panthers come in undefeated. Would they remain so? Andrew Luck and the Colts atop the AFC South. Colts off to a rough start early on. Trouble out the gate as the snap is fumbled.
Quarterback center exchange. They say one of the easiest plays in football. And the center never got the ball to Andrew Luck. That's not his fault.
New center, too.
And in conditions, you know, it's wet and it's rainy.
Panthers get on the board first with a Graham Gano field goal. They're up 3-0 in the next Colts possession. Andrew Luck looking for T.Y. Hilton, intercepted by Charles Tillman. Take another look.
Peanut, I see you, Peanut.
Yeah, here's a little pressure coming off the edge. And I don't know what he's seeing, but it's just like he just forced the ball. He had Allen wide open just to miss throw. Bad, poorly thrown ball.
Or just throw the ball out of bounds.
So two turnovers for the Colts on their first two possessions. And so Riverboat Ron Rivera, he's feeling a little cocky. He's going to take some chances on fourth and one there.
When you have Avatar at quarterback, Amber, you can do that on fourth and one.
Okay, four plays later. Now fourth and one from the three. Jonathan Stewart powering. You like that, M-Rob?
Oh, yeah, of course. Running back love. Return of the back. Jay Stewart gets low, uses his feet, and gets in the end zone again. Power football in the red zone.
Drug three guys in with him.
Telling you.
Panthers lead 10-0. Let's go to the third quarter. Panthers ball. They're up 17-6, and it's their turn for a miscue.
Can't have it. You cannot have turnovers inside of the red zone, especially inside of the five.
And you see right here, Cam.
Throw Like a Girl Radio, WBCR's first all-female sports talk show, is back until 12 p.m. We have about a half hour left. I think there's some technical difficulties going on with our internet right now.
Buffering!
So you heard some of the highlights from Monday Night Football's Colts-Panthers matchup. Panthers are one of the four teams currently still undefeated going into week 9 of the season. We got to talk about Andrew Luck because I am a big, big, big Andrew Luck fan. And I still think that despite his start, he's 1-5 as a starter, playing in just 6 out of the 8 in Indianapolis games. Mm-hmm. And 2 out of the 3 wins from Indianapolis came from Matt Hasselbeck, their backup quarterback.
Yes.
However, they just got rid of their offensive coordinator, Pep Hamilton, who was in his third season in charge of the once very threatening world offenses in the NFL. And he had them ranked 20th in NFL for scoring, 16th in total offense, 24th in rushing, 31st in giveaways, which is really crazy. Luck is only 26 years old. Let's think about that. He's still young. Several times. And it was released on Sunday morning from Fox Sports' Jay Glazer that he has been playing through multiple fractured ribs. And when those reports come out, which is why the teams try to keep those under wraps, the defense, the other team, tried to aim for his torso, which is what the Panthers were doing, and they were doing a good job of it. Why not magnitude the weakness of your opponent?
So I'm just gonna say, Luck Andrew, not so lucky Luck. I know you like how I did
that. So corny.
I came up with that yesterday while I was writing these notes. But he's playing
26 other teams in the NFL would rather him than their quarterback they have now.
The four teams
being the teams that are undefeated going into week 9: the Panthers, Bengals, Broncos, and Patriots.
Well, we gotta say this. He struggled through the first three quarters of that game, and then all of a sudden, beast mode through the fourth quarter. So
you
why
saw the old Andrew Luck that everyone
so
knows
So why
and
couldn't
loves.
He bring that in the beginning of the game?
It was also raining. It was torrential
okay,
rain.
Okay, congratulations.
I don't think he's getting a lot of support. His offensive line takes a ton of penalties. Tons of penalties.
But he's making poor decisions, too.
Also,
it's
he's
like
throwing more than he's ever thrown in his career. He's averaging over 260 yards per game, the second best mark of his four-year career, but it's mainly due to the fact that he's throwing more than he ever has. And
well, they have been complaining.
He has 43 passes per game. His complete percentage is around 55%. And his now, which is also increasing his interception rate because, mm-hmm. you know, I mean, that just makes sense. If you're throwing more and more chances of being intercepted. So his interception rate is probably around 5% now, I want to say. So, I don't know. I still think that despite the slow start and one of the worst starts he has had, I do think that it's not even that it's a bad start. It's just not what you expect from Andrew Luck. And I think that that's what everyone and all these people are saying he's overrated and blah, blah, blah. And Skip Bayless sent out a tweet the other day that he's a turnover machine, which, yeah, that's probably true here. But I don't think it's – I think now with the new offensive coordinator coming in, hopefully they'll be able to make adjustments to help speak to the strengths of Andrew Luck's mm-hmm. game and that he'll be able to turn around. But Monday Night Football was really exciting. Overtime, I think overtime in football – even though it is kind of annoying because if you get a hot take, you end up winning the game. But I don't know. I really enjoyed Monday Night Football's game. It's the first game I've actually sat down and watched in a while because of the Mets run. I've kind of been putting football on the back burner. But I don't know. I enjoyed it. It was interesting to see because, you know, Cam Newton and Andrew Luck are both first-round draft picks. And you can mm-hmm. see how the weather was really affecting them. It was pouring. And it kind of seemed like I was thinking watching the game. I was like, this might be really fun to play in as far as I don't know. It's probably not ideal to play in, obviously, because you can't grip the ball, and there's just a bunch of fumbles and things like that. But it seemed like it would be fun to play in just for fun. But
okay. Are you okay now?
Yeah.
Okay, so with Andrew Luck, also, he's changed in the fourth quarter, like I said before, and he's completed 18 of 29 passes. And he passed for 197 yards, 2 touchdowns, and 20 unanswered points. So he really came out of it, his little funk, but still lost in overtime against the Panthers. So
he did throw 3 interceptions,
and they said
which you can't do.
There was rumors about like coaching in front office, and they're putting pressure on him because there's all like crazy controversy going on back there. And
I mean,
I
did think he has a lot of pressure in general, just because he's come in on such with he's proved what he can do, and he has such high expectations since his rookie season. I mean, he made it to the playoffs so many times. You know, what I mean, as a rookie, so. I think that hopefully the new offensive coordinator, former Browns head coach Rob Chudzinski.
These names, these last names.
So he will take over the position and hopefully, like I said before, capitalize on what, you know, get that offensive line into shape and stop taking so many penalties and give
it's
him
still
support.
Early in the season,
and
too.
Hopefully he can just play through his fractured ribs. I mean, that can't be comfortable, but he has to do what he has to do.
And just getting tackled, it's got to hurt a lot. Well, your Jetsies.
Oh, man.
Can we say Jetsies?
No.
Can I start it?
Go for it.
All right.
I'll start it.
It's not going to carry on, catch on. Your Jetsies lost against the Raiders, darling. They lost 2 games in a row. Your defense has been poopy.
really bad. Yeah. So this is like another one of those games where you just are reminded as a Jets fan that the franchise quarterback is not currently on the roster.
Yeah. What happened to your QBs? Both of them are injured.
Now they're
girl.
Both injured. And I don't know. We need to do something. I mean, Colin Kaepernick was benched, and I was like, it was a slight inclination I had that maybe they would figure out something that they would be able to get him by the trade deadline because it was interesting the time he was placed on the bench. However, it doesn't make really a lot of sense for San Francisco to do that. They'd get more value for him in the offseason anyway. But, okay. This is just my harsh reminder that we do not have a quarterback. And Bryce Petty, probably, I don't know, maybe he will start on Sunday. Maybe he'll do something miraculous. Mm-hmm. But none of these guys are who we need for the long haul, for what the program wants to do. They're just not there.
I don't think the
Chris Ivory has been underutilized in the past couple weeks. He's had 32 carries, 58 yards. That's nothing. The Jets won't win many more games with the complete absence of his run game. So Nick Mangold, Powell, hopefully their return will help, you know, get those numbers up for him. And I don't know. They have to. Marshall's been covered like crazy, but they have to. That's the scariest part about Sunday is Petty, whoever's in Petty, Gino, one. No thumbed Fitzpatrick. They need to throw to Marshall even in the coverage because he is, you know, even though he dropped a crucial play against the Patriots, he's the guy that you got to throw to, even though, like I said several times, I'm not a fan of Brandon Marshall. But you got to do what you got to do to get the win. And
that's
they
true.
Need
you
to get
guys
back.
Are still a
they
game above 500, though.
They need to get back in the win column. For
well,
sure.
You guys are going to verse Buffalo Bills
and tackle
and
better. Please tackle better.
Yo, your defense is...
Calvin Pryor being out is really hurting them.
Your defense needs to wake up just a little bit, just like the Cowboys, but we'll get to that in a second. Why do my rant there? But you guys are going to be hosting the Jacksonville Jaguars and the Buffalo Bills, which they're both a below 500
We
team.
Need to get ready for the Buffalo Bills. Rex Ryan comes back to MetLife on November 12th.
Oh, God.
And
you guys
cannot
are
win.
Like, you guys are going to go after him, aren't you? I have a feeling. Well, also, in other news in football, Tennessee Titans have fired their coach, Ken Wisenhunt. Is that how you pronounce it? Wisenhunt. Wisenhunt. Same thing. The record the record is 1-6. So, and he was less than 2 years he's been head coach.
He's they only won 3 games.
Yes. He should have been fired long ago, guys. All right. He lost 6 straight games, but the team drafted Mariota, which... That's why they drafted him, because of the inconsistency of their past 2 seasons. And now their assistant head coach and tight end coach, Mike Mularkey, is the new head coach. For now, tenure. We'll see what happens there.
And he's had a previous head coaching job with the Bills and the Jags. So hopefully he can turn the ship around and, you know, lead them back. But Wisenhunt had trouble keeping the lead and making play calls. There was 2 games he had in the fourth quarter and the third quarter.
Yeah.
The fourth quarter against the Colts, he lost a 27-14 lead and a third quarter lead 10-0 over the Bills. So you can't do that when you have, I don't know. You just can't. You can't.
Well, the
lose
Cowboys have been doing that too. They've been losing leads, but we'll get to that soon. Well, also
the Cowboys always making back page news, front page.
Oh,
news.
The Cowboys give me a headache.
Love,
I can't do this. I can't
headlines.
Do this.
They
I think it's
it.
Worse this year than ever.
It's honestly,
honestly
refreshing not having the Jets constantly in headlines. Even
you
though
know,
they still kind of are.
America's team is back in the headlines, but not for the reasons you want. But guys, NFL standings. That's pretty amazing that how many teams? Four teams are 7-0.
Four
now?
Teams are 7-0. And the only reason, quite possibly the only reason why there haven't been five teams is because the Broncos played the Packers and the Packers are the other team that was.
Yes.
So one of the teams had to lose and that's why there's only four. So Patriots, Bengals, Broncos all going into week
and
9
Panthers.
Undefeated. And Panthers, sorry, yep.
And Panthers are in undefeated. Okay, and should we get to Jerry Jones, guys? I know you guys are itching. Itching to talk
also,
about
one,
Mr. Jones.
Just an interesting,
all right, give it to us.
Just an interesting tidbit. I'm pretty sure the Bengals are playing the Browns this weekend, and I'm pretty sure last year when they had their undefeated run, they lost to the Browns in an upset loss. So,
yeah.
I was going to say, Johnny Manziel has just been named the starter for this weekend, so
mm-hmm.
I think the Bengals are very focused on not letting that happen again to keep their record perfect. So
I would
want
to keep
so,
my record perfect going into the playoffs.
I mean,
that's pretty
the goal
awesome.
Every year, isn't it?
True that. Okay, guys, Jerry Jones. The Cowboys, their record is 2-5, but we're still in it in our division, which is pretty awesome, even though we've lost 5 games in a row.
The Cowboys had a moral compass this weekend, didn't they?
I don't know. I don't want to talk. Let's talk about how they released Joseph
that's
Randall.
What I'm saying. They had a moral compass. The guy is in possible violation of NFL's conduct policy.
Why do you sign him to begin with?
Because we were talking about this. They don't care.
I know.
Jerry Jones cares about the dollar signs, and that's it.
He was supposed to replace DeMarco Murray, which is kind of a joke because he hasn't been producing as much and gaining yards and all this stuff. He was also, he didn't play last week because he was dealing with a personal issue because there was a phone call. He made a phone call to his to the police about the whereabouts of his girlfriend. So his mental health is not there, and that's why he didn't play last week. So he's just a ticking time bomb waiting to go off, and finally they released him, which was somewhat of a decent move for the Cowboys. Great job, Jerry. Randall ran for 315 yards and a team high of 4 touchdowns on 76 carries in 5 games with them. And he's still waiting for his suspension for what happened in February, which he wasn't charged legally, but the NFL could still do something.
They never are charged legally.
I know. But still, he could still be disciplined. And there was a domestic violence case. That's what it was. And that happened in February. Should we talk about a monkey?
Yeah, it's kind of weird. Jerry Jones was heard on his weekly appearance on some Dallas radio station talking about Des Bryant apparently got a monkey as a household pet, and PETA found out about this and made this whole big stink about it.
PETA always does that, though. They always have to, like, stick their heads and think, that monkey's probably treated like a princess or a prince.
But a monkey shouldn't be a domestic animal.
Yeah, it's legal in some states, not in DeSoto, Texas, but it might not be there.
Yeah, which is where he is.
But
you but
there's no evidence yet. That's why they haven't taken the monkey away.
Because if you break the law, you break the law.
I know, but he doesn't. There's no evidence that he has the monkey there.
Either way, I just thought it was very interesting that Jerry Jones made a comment about this. And like I said to Kara before, he always, regardless of what his players do, regardless of his decision making, he always comes to bat for his players no matter what.
Know.
He was on the radio show talking for a good 5 minutes about how much he loved monkeys, how he could watch them all day in the zoo, and that he thinks that, you know,
Jerry Jones living in La La Land, he needs to get out of this.
But that's that.
Should we take a break, or do you want to just
let's go
into
hockey,
dude? Because
we don't have much time.
We got to talk about
a
lot of things.
Biggest yes. news coming out of hockey this morning, last night. Rookie All Star, already proclaimed the next great one.
Wayne Gretzky.
Wayne Gretzky's successor.
Oh, Rookie of the Month, by the way. So all of you guys who were freaking out about Connor McDavid's beginning, Rookie of the Month, but.
He last night against the Philadelphia Flyers.
Yes.
Edmonton had their worst nightmare, hit on Connor McDavid, leaves his arm in a sling, and he is out for an extended period of time. Last night there was no report, clear indication of
what
the specific injury was.
Yeah.
This morning it broke that it was a collarbone.
Yeah.
There's rumors about a collarbone. There's really rumors about a shoulder.
Regardless,
he's out for an extended period of time, which is devastating for the rookie class because it was really, really exciting.
I know,
exciting
this would have been such
about
a sick year.
To see how these guys are going to match up against each other.
Yeah.
He's leading all rookies with 12 points in his first 12 games.
Yeah. But now it's.
He got tangled up with our. Flyers blue liner Delzato.
Oh, that's our
and
boy.
And Brandon Manning and disaster. You know,
it could
have really,
been
see
much
the play?
I didn't see the play, but it could have been much worse, though.
They were kind of
how
he was going to the net and
hit.
Manning was coming, you know, trying to get him from behind. And
yeah.
I guess they both just lost their footing and
all
three of them went into the boards together. But McDavid was on the bottom going in shoulder first into the boards, which is always a scary sight because, you know, that the separated shoulder, the neck contusions, all things like that are the first things that come to your mind.
It's very painful. And I heard that they heard the boards, like the sound of the collision, you could hear it from the rafters. So it was a pretty scary moment, but he's on long-term injury reserved, which is not good for Edmonton. And
no, not at all. But the one bright side of this is that now.
What's the bright side?
It's not really a bright side. This is a bad thing. That's a bad way to put it. But now all the other rookies in this class who are competing for the Calder Trophy, they have not almost like a fair shot, but kind of a fair shot. Because
now we can focus on Eichel.
You can see a Domi.
Max Domi.
Lindbergh.
Yeah.
So now all these guys have like a fighting chance almost to show it. Like, not that they were going
to
show what
they
have
regardless. Like, now the attention can be put on them to
scouts. But now people can start looking at them and see what they are bringing to
this.
The table instead of them being in the shadows of McDavid. However, you never want a player as young as him to get hurt. And hopefully speedy recovery, because I really was looking forward to seeing him play.
I know. He's 18 years old, and he's just been so consistent. But we also have to talk about, because Alyssa wanted to bring this up, Steven Stamkos' contract extension.
It still isn't signed, which is insane to me.
They don't have the money.
I don't care. He's Steven Stamkos.
They don't have money right now, and he still has to finish the year, and we'll see what happens.
It is Steven Stamkos, and it's Tampa Bay, Florida. You need to sign him as soon as possible.
Do
whatever you need to do. Do whatever you need to do to sign this man.
All right, they will. He'll probably get 8 years, $84 million, just like Kane and Taves did in Chicago, or something around that. But they just need to get the money. They have, a $5.5 million cap hit or something like that?
Yeah.
I was reading something about the cap hit, and they just don't have the money right now. So let them trade
Make
some
your
players.
Maneuvers, see what you got to do.
They will. They'll do what they got to do. He has six
or
goals and two assists this season.
Or else he's
going to
get scooped up really quick.
I'll scoop him up.
Rangers. No, the Rangers have zero cap room for him.
I know.
They barely have cap room for what they have.
I know. I'll put in I'll put in a dollar. How's that? That'll make a difference. Also, guys, Rangers and Washington Capitals. The Rangers won yesterday against the Capitals 5-2, I think it was.
Yes.
5-2. It was a pretty good game. Oscar Lindbergh.
Speaking
that's all
of
I
rookies.
Gotta say. Speaking of rookies, he's been on point. He's been consistent. We're on a 5-game home streak right now. And what happened? There was something with Stahl and Ovechkin.
Yeah.
Stahl speared Ovechkin, but that was only because Ovechkin almost took off Stahl's head in
the repercussion.
Period.
Tactics in games like that, especially in a regular season game. If you do it in a postseason game, it's even worse because there's more at stake there. But Just play the game.
Our transitions have been good, though, on odd man rushes, I've noticed. Our transitions have been good.
We need to talk about Henrik Lundqvist.
Capitalizing on turnovers. That's what the Rangers have been doing. Great job so far. Talk about Henrik Lundqvist.
Okay, Henrik Lundqvist is the only reason why they stayed in that game, because the second period was horrible. I did not watch any of the game, but I looked at the stats.
No, it was bad.
It was 25 shot attempts by Washington, as opposed to like the 3 or 8 or something by the Rangers. 14 shots on goals, 5-on-5 scoring chances for Washington. Lundqvist kept him in, bailed him out.
No, they didn't. Without a doubt. But we scored 2 goals in that period.
He has been so intense this season. I was reading an article this morning that says basically when he left, when he was packing up the locker room, the Rangers, challenged him, William Vigneault. And who's the goalie coach? Why can't I think of his name?
Benny Allaire. Yeah,
Benny Allaire.
He's the reason why.
AKA the goalie whisperer.
He's the goaltending coach of the century, honestly.
He challenged Lundqvist to try and refocus his offseason training so that he can come into the season starting off strong. And, because he's notorious for getting off to this slow start.
Yes.
But he's had one of the best starts of his career. 6-2-2, 1.88 goals against average, save percent of .943, which is insane.
Sick.
And there was actually a really interesting comment made by backup goalie Ranta, saying that after they had lost in overtime in the shootout against the Flyers, when Giroux and who else was it who did that fancy move on him?
Oh,
I can't remember, but
he
was before Giroux. So
what's his name?
They said it was in the locker room, and Lundqvist said, "I'm so bad at shootouts right now." And Ranta said, "No, you're not." And he's like, "Yes." And it just shows his intensity. He's such an intense guy. He is the anchor in that locker room and just honing in on focusing on what he wants is so bad. And he knows his window is closing. He knows that the team's window is closing.
No, it is. I think this is last year. This is it.
He had 32 saves last night, and it just really is a standout performance, which is not that you don't expect this from him. You expect this from him in December and January.
Not in November and October. Yeah.
He usually takes him a couple months to warm up to the
league
again.
Now he's legitimately in his prime. This is his prime year. That's it. And the Islanders also won yesterday 2-1. And also, the Stanley Cup made its rounds and is now back to the Hockey Hall of Fame. So now it's
up for grabs,
everybody.
Up for grabs.
Let's go to the Hall of Fame. Let's take it and bring it to the Garden. I'm down. Let's do it. And also, Jarrett Stahl scored his first goal as a New York Ranger in the third period. So congratulations, Jarrett Stahl.
Yeah, and we should probably congratulate the Kansas City Royals.
No, I don't want to.
No, you got to do it.
Why?
So congrats. Because, I don't know, it's just the right thing to do, I guess.
Oh, yeah.
Like, it's good karma for next year.
Oh, it's like the moral thing to do. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry, I can't stop thinking about it.
You just brought it up again.
It's like the monkey on my back.
I tried to, put that memory to the side, and now I'm, moving out of my life trying to.
No, I should have worn all black on Monday as, a funeral.
Oh, did I wear all black?
It was literally, watching someone die on TV.
Oh, my God. I wore all black, and then I wore, a blue blazer because I was going to work for the Mets, because I was like, let me just wear it, screw it, wear a little blue. I'm still proud of what they've done. It's just been,
but just, you know, that's the you want your team to make it as far as they can, but when they do it and they don't
and
take it
want,
all
yeah,
it just it hurts so much more. It's
it
almost
is.
Like, not that you don't wish that they went as far as they did, but it's like
you were
so much
close.
Less it'd be so much less more less painful.
And we haven't
did.
Witnessed a championship, you and I. We have never.
Yeah,
been
Kara,
to
thanks
parade.
For much. Yeah. No, I'm fully aware of that reality.
I am
fully aware.
And people say 2005. I'm like, dude, I was 5 years old. Do I remember what I was doing yesterday? No, come on, guys.
I never even got to win a championship in high school or anything. I've gone
I know.
To championships.
Oh,
never
I've
won.
Won a I won the Brooklyn champs. Does that count?
In softball?
Yeah, it was the Brooklyn champs.
Weak division.
Wow. Oh, you want it? Wow. I have my sweater, Brooklyn Champs 2010. I rocked it.
Yeah.
Don't be jealous, Alyssa. You don't have a sweater.
I don't. You're right. Maybe I am jealous.
TMLA was all right.
TMLA.
I don't understand where you have the T in front of the M and the LA. Because
it's the Mary Lewis Academy.
It just can't be Mary Lewis Academy.
No.
I always made fun of your stuff. We played softball, if you guys don't know what we're talking about.
Yeah, that was really bad. We didn't give any background on that.
We played
softball against each other in high school. So.
Yeah, we did. Oh, I remember that. Okay. Play the music, girl.
Woman of the week. Tell them who it is, Kara.
Mary Kittany. Kittany. It's a very complicated last name.
Well, in the spirit of the post New York City Marathon.
Yes, she's our woman of the week. She won. She's from Kenya. And this is her second year in a row that she's won the marathon, which is historic because only 8 women have won the course more than once in the marathon's 45-year history. She ran 26.2 2-mile course in 2 hours, 24 minutes, and 25 seconds, which is amazing because I can't even run 1 mile, and she ran 26 of them. And she also has set several world records and has won major races, including also the London Marathon, which is pretty impressive. And she has 2 children. How do you have time to train and you have 2 kids and giving birth to these 2 kids in the past couple of years? That's insane. You're still running and you're winning these marathons, and
it's people like her that make me realize how amazing the human body is.
It's sick.
It can do things that you don't think that you should be able to do, but she clearly can do them.
I know. Congratulations. And I think they won, what, $250,000?
Oh, I have no idea. But the New York City Marathon is one of my favorite events of the year. I used to live on the trail.
Yeah.
And that used to be one of my favorite weekends of the fall because, you know, everyone was out and I would hand out, like, you know, oranges and cups.
So
yeah,
kind.
One of my friends from high school, actually, I played softball with, Chelsea Taper. She finished the New York Marathon.
Oh, she's
New
crazy. City
Marathon.
She
so
did
congrats,
that whole
Chelsea.
Thing.
She's I don't think she's listening, but if you are, congrats, Chelsea. There's your shout out.
Oh, that would have taken me. I would still be running right now.
I forgot she posted her time. I can look it up and see. But
yeah, look at
not,
the time.
I mean, not clearly no, as, not as impressive as her,
not
but
as
it was
impressive.
Still pretty impressive.
I would still be running right now.
I'd still be in Queens.
I'd still be.
No, I always said that when I was growing up that I would really want to run the New York City Marathon, the Boston Marathon, San Francisco, which is one of the hardest ones because of all the inclines.
Yeah, but
she ran the marathon, my friend Chelsea Taper, in 3 hours, 49 minutes, and 31
wow,
seconds.
Wow, she's only like an hour and 20 minutes.
She's also in the Coast Guard, so she's like pretty good shape. But
Alyssa, we got to – that's it. Next year, we're going to run
that's the goal.
I'm going
to
walk
the marathon.
You have
to qualify for it. You have to run a bunch of like half marathons and
really?
Other things to have certain times. Yeah, like it's like a lottery system because it's such – there's some type of process to get into it.
So we'll walk around the marathon. How's that? We'll be
no, if I'm doing it, I'm going to run it.
You're going to go fully?
Oh, yeah.
We have to start training now.
Yeah, for sure. At least.
Oh, God. All right. So there you have it. We've just made an announcement. We'll be running the marathon next year, which we'll see if that actually happens. That'll be insane. But congratulations, Mary, and continue doing what you're doing. Maybe you'll win it next year. Be the first woman in history to win 3 years in a row. And that'd be pretty awesome. So great job. And everyone, there you have it. What is this? What episode is this? Number 10.
Number 10. There's only 5 more. Oh. Season 2. Almost over.
I know. And we've been having such a great time doing this. And that's it, ladies and gents. Another week of Throw Like a Girl Radio comes to a close. We hope you enjoyed tuning in. We didn't get any callers today.
I know.
Guys.
Last week we got like 10 this week, and we still couldn't answer the phone. This week we have nothing.
The phone is actually working this week. Yeah. Can we get a phone call? Just saying hi. 718-951-4444. Even though we have like 1 minute left, just call and be like, yo, what's up, guys? Thank you for tuning in. I'm Carrie Galante.
I'm Alyssa Paolicelli.
We'll be back same time, same place. This is also CUNY's first all-female sports talk show, so please tune in. It's awesome. We're here every Wednesday from 11 to 12, right before you take your lunch break. Don't forget to follow us on social media, facebook.com/throwlikeagirlradio, Twitter @throwlikea_girl, and Instagram @throwlikeagirlradio. We'll be posting this episode on our YouTube channel. Just search Throw Like a Girl Radio, and also be on iTunes, so make sure you follow social media and listen to our beautiful voices and enjoy your
and
week.
And like, comment, share.
Call, comment. do we have to end this?
Yeah. Well, the holiday season is like almost here. So at least if you still feel like Wednesday is you have a long week to go, just know that the holiday season's almost here. We'll be back same time, same place next week.
Yeah. Apparently Christmas is coming because apparently Thanksgiving doesn't exist anymore.
But yeah, until then, see you later, guys. Mm-hmm.